Welcome back
to the final episode.
Darren, this is the end of the third day, the final module, 8 modules a day. This is module 24.
In fact, damn it, I'm done.
We have presented the entire Build conference. I mean, it's a 3 days, nonstop sessions.
Yeah, unfortunately, it was Build 2005.
There was no Build. You know, but it's crazy.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
We covered a lot of ground.
Never a typo. Never a misspoken word.
Exactly. And never every demo worked first time.
Never had a problem with the demo, despite working with Barry so much.
Exactly.
It's crazy how it all plays out.
Yeah, we're not actually doing anything when our hands come down here. We're actually just working over a virtual demo that's just playing back.
Right, we've never done anything, funny enough.
Yeah, we're just marionettes.
I mean, at the end, the fireworks go off at the end of this one. It's pretty exciting.
Yeah.
We've saved the best for last. Certainly some interesting things that you can do. Certainly some difficult things, I don't mind saying.
Yeah.
Useful, and it's probably worth the investment as a developer to go ahead and do this. Primarily and only, we're going to be talking about the live SDK, interacting with live services. That includes authenticating with your Microsoft account. Remember, when you're signed into Windows 8, unless you're on a domain, you've signed in with a live account. Even on a domain, you can associate to your live account. So that enables the opportunity to access their profile. That includes their name, email, and whatever else they might share with you. It also gives you the opportunity to access their profile picture. That's pretty cool. It also gives you the ability to have single sign-on so that you can get permission once. And then from that point forward, you don't have to prompt the user to log in again. We've implemented all that in our sample app, which is available for download at xaml.codeplex.com. It's in the XAML Part 2. That's the advanced session that we're in right now. This is on for the third day. And then we also have the capability of, in fact, let me run the application and just kind of show what I'm talking about here. Whenever we're inside an individual record, right, so here I am inside the application. Whenever I'm inside an individual record, it has notes, and I'm able to type into those notes. Those notes are then persisted in SkyDrive.
Yes.
Very cool. We didn't have to store them in SkyDrive.
No, we had a number of different options, but we wanted to go through a scenario where we were interacting with SkyDrive and showing you how you can create folders, create files, write information up there, and then bring it back down.
We just were looking for some way to use SkyDrive.
Yeah, a random excuse.
Yeah, exactly. And so we'll go through both the login and we'll go through the SkyDrive piece, and we'll start right now.
Sounds good.
All right. In order to use any of these pieces, now we'll start talking about Windows Live SDK. Let's talk about it. All right. So, of course, Windows Live ID has been renamed to Microsoft Account. So when we say Microsoft Account, Windows Live ID.
Which used to be called Passport.
Which used to be called Passport.net. Yeah, that's right.
Indeed.
Way ahead of its time.
Yes.
Way ahead of its time. A universal ID for all these services. And it didn't hit like it should have. But nonetheless, it's amazing. I think we're averaging 65 million logins a day using the Windows account. No doubt that number is increasing dramatically with Windows 8 leveraging that account.
Indeed.
That's what it was before Windows 8 back in release candidate days. But anyway, so pretty cool. The Live SDK is a wrapper for accessing all of these services. Those services are REST services. And it uses OAuth 2.0, as you know. And the API is effective.
Idiosyncratic.
Yeah, it certainly does not make it ridiculously simple, right? Hopefully you bill by the hour if you're going to be implementing this. And then you're in good shape. But nonetheless, we've implemented it.
Yeah.
And I have a live helper that's in this. It's also on my blog at jerrynixon.com.
Good one.
And you can get that, or you can just pull it out of this project as well. And it helps simplify it a little bit as far as logging in. It doesn't necessarily help SkyDrive. That's another helper that we've written specific just for this. And it's a little more specific perhaps to our implementation.
Yeah, it's a rudimentary helper that we'll be continuing to work on.
Yeah, yeah. Anyway, so that's That's the Live SDK. The Live SDK gives you access to not just the profile, which is important, not just SkyDrive, which of course we know that now, but it also gives you access to Outlook.com, which of course is our mail, also gives you access to the user's contact list, also gives you access to the user's task list, also gives you access to the user's
calendar.
All four. Yeah, that's right. And so that's very powerful. I mean, think of the types of apps you might run to be able to pull the user's calendar and check what's their new email, things like that. Very cool. Very cool.
And Skype.
And Skype as well. That's right. Now that Messenger is being retired, Skype is the new messaging solution. And of course, Live ID or Live SDK used to go into Messenger. Now it goes into Skype.
Yeah. It's going to be interesting to see where we can go with that.
Yeah, it is. It is. We don't have anything to do with Skype in this application, but it's worth noting.
Yeah, basically in this application, you cannot contact us and ask us questions directly.
Not through instant message, at least,
exactly.
Right?
But you can call Barry.
Yeah. Barry's going to keep all the notes in the end. Barry woo-hoos every time we say his name now.
I know.
Oh, my goodness.
He's completely on board.
Listen to Barry.
I know.
Oh, man. Is that...
He's giving it all he's got.
Who needs Scotty when you got Barry? All right. Microsoft account is good for a couple of things, and probably the first primary one is for authentication. You want to make sure the user is who they say they are. This can be very valuable because, you know, you may have an application and you only want certain people to be able to use it. Maybe they purchased it or whatever. You can use authentication to verify the user's email, and they only provide you back if they know the username and password. So that's really nice as far as authentication, identifying who the person is. Personalization as well. So once I know the user and I have an ID for that user, now I can start saving personalized information, personal settings and things like that into a back-end store. And it's attached to their account. So then they can go from app to app to app or device to device to device or website or wherever, and I can recognize who they are yet again, right? Because I know their email address or ID or whatever. I can get more information about them. How are you going to ask a user their first name and last name? Well, you're going to have to prompt them, or you just pull it directly from their account. Very cool. Same thing with image. Very nice. And then we have this idea of scopes. And scopes allows you to drill in, like, what can you access for this user? And, of course, we know this from other OAuth providers, like Twitter and LinkedIn and Gmail and Google account, whatever it's called, the Facebook account. You know, they all have this same sort of thing of what can you do? I can for Facebook. You know, I can see their posts. I can make a post. I can all these other things. Mm-hmm. We have that as well. It's scopes, and you get to ask all these things. I can have their name. I can have also their email. I can have their picture and continue on. So we have basic and sign in. Basic gives me the basic information from their profile, their name and email, not email. Just name. And and picture. And then I can ask for email specifically.
So effectively, you can do basic personalization.
Basic personalization with basic. Yes. Nice work. That's really nice. And then I can use sign in. And sign in basically says, if I sign in once, I don't have to sign in again. It's that single sign in option. It's very nice. Very powerful. And so there are some guidelines around this that if you do have the user log in, you want to give them the ability to log out. That can be sort of tricky if you want to, depending on the scope that you're using. And that's it. You want to show the user that they're logged in so they don't forget, you know, and you want to leverage it. And you want to kind of respect their privacy as well.
Sure. Why don't you show how we integrate that into our application?
All right. So I have the app already running here. Microsoft account is disabled. So I'll go into the settings of the app here. I'll go into settings and I'll say enable the Microsoft account. There we are. Now it's enabled. Of course, no change here because it's a big deal, right? So I'm going, how do I do that? I don't remember. Let's see. I go back to the main. Oh, there it is. All right. So the splash screen is what handles all the work for me. The splash screen is where I go because, you know, that's we talked about that earlier where we kind of offload long-running processes. One of those long-running processes is going to go out to the Windows Live Services using the SDK and get all the information about the current user. Anyway, so you can see in the top right-hand corner, I'm Mr. Microsoft, and that's my first name and last name from my account. It knows my email address, and it also has my picture. That's pretty fun.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so that's the basics of logging in. So how do we do it? We better look at the code. All right. So if I were to look at the start screen, the splash screen, like so.
Any old screen.
If I were to look at one of these screens, and I was going to go to the long-running process section. Let me just jump to it. I'm not going to jump to it. I'm going to scroll to it. Oop, I passed it. There we are. All right, so this is the section that we are going to look at together. And basically, I look to see whether or not logins are allowed. Remember, that's that setting that I just changed. And so in this case, it is. And so I'll go down, and I'll say helpers.livesdk.loginasync. So remember, I created a helper for the live SDK. This is it. It exposes a static method called loginasync, an asynchronous method that calls out to the service for us and tries to log in the current user. Now, here's what's beautiful about that. Let me just jump to what's in that method. So this is that login method. And so the first thing it does is it creates the authentication client. So this is around OAuth, right? This is what's going to go get the... this is not yet around OAuth. This is about creating the UI and creating how we're going to prompt the user in the first place. This knows that I'm in Windows 8, so it knows that when I ask for a username and password, it needs to look a certain way. I also give it a little hint to say, when it builds that, colorize it so that it's the light theme so it fits nicely with my application. I could also pick the dark theme. And so that's when it prompts the user, you know, what the background is. Okay, so if they are not logged out, I attempt to log them out. And then one last thing here, I call the client, that same client right here, which is the proxy for the REST calls. I call login async there, pass in all of the scopes. So we talked about sign in as the single sign in, basic to get their information. Emails, this is how we get that. And of course, we also have added SkyDrive, and we've added SkyDrive update, and we'll talk about that in a little bit.
Yep.
And anyway, so now I get the login result, and the login result is what allows me to determine whether or not they said yes. Mm-hmm. And if they said yes and logged in fine, then there's another step. They've approved it, I've got the token, and now I'm ready to use that token, that's the OAuth token, to go out and make a request to the service and ask for all of their profile information. And that's what I do in this next section, is I go out and I get me. Of course, we haven't talked about me yet because mm-hmm. that's going to be in SkyDrive.
We're always talking about you, Jerry.
We're always talking about me. I am, at least, yeah. And anyway, so that's where I go get me, and me is my basic profile. Gets all of that. Next section down so here,
but
I also get the
basically, we've
picture.
Got a slash me. And the interesting thing to point out here is that is part of a REST URI call.
Yeah, you're right.
Basically what's happening here is we've got an OAuth token that allows us to interact with the live SDK REST services. We've got the get async, which is allowing us to marshal a call out to a REST endpoint, which is slash me. The thing that the SDK is providing us is it's automatically inserting the endpoint for the web call that we're making.
And the OAuth token.
And it's adding the OAuth token into the authorization headers.
Yeah, and that's you could do it.
Yes, you could absolutely do it.
Yeah, and so when you were creating this Live Connect client and passing in the session, this Live Connect client is the thing that knows where the endpoint is, and this session is what knows what that OAuth token is.
Correct.
Right? It really is simple. They make mm-hmm. it seem so complicated, but it's just not. And then this get async is just that HTTP get, mm-hmm. that's all. And yep. And then you're passing in the beginning of the...
URI string.
Of the URI string for the REST protocol, yeah. Right. That's exactly right. And so here it is. I go and get me. So me comes back as a dictionary of values. This and that, this and that, this and that. It's a real pain.
Yeah.
And then I go out and get the photo. So now that I have the picture, I can go and actually get the URL as well, or go get the URL and load the image as well. And so because it's a dictionary, why I wrote a helper for it is because it's just not strongly typed. You're always asking mm-hmm. for a string, and that's kind of silly. Sometimes there's an error when you ask for something that is or isn't there, and it just adds to all of your code. And so the last line here is that user equals new live ID. Live ID is the wrapper class that makes it strongly typed. That's yep. the whole business. Oh, it's pretty nice. So it's pretty nice. So back to the page of where we did it. Well, here in the splash, that's funny. I must have closed it by mistake. So all I have to call is, right here. I get the whether or not it has, the login is successful or not. And so they attempt to log in. This is a nullable Boolean. So if it doesn't have a value, I know that there was an error for one reason or another. I can't really interrogate too much of the error. I just know there was one.
Kind of a closed box to us.
Kind of a closed box to us, right. And if there is a value, then, hey, that's great. You just logged in. Now I can go get your information. And there is this other option of false, and that means they could have logged in. Nothing went wrong. They just said,
no,
forget you.
Yes.
You got to handle all those cases, right, and just kind of go from there. Of course, here I have a to-do handle fail. So, yeah, so that's going to be up to you and how you want to do it inside your application.
Exactly.
Anyway, that allows me to get the user or to go out and it prompts the user. I don't build the UI for that, by the way. The SDK does the whole thing. And then it goes out, pulls all the information for the user. Now it's in a static property, and I have all the information that I need for the user control. I've just authenticated the user, Darren.
Mm-hmm.
Now let's use that that authenticated user to access live services.
Sounds like a good plan.
All right.
Shall we branch on and talk about SkyDrive?
I think so. I think so, yes.
Exactly. Okay.
Wait, hang on.
Oh.
Show the slide for a second. Let's talk about SkyDrive.
Let's have a Jeff moment. He's going to hate us. It's a good job it's the last one.
It's the last one no matter what, I
exactly.
Think.
Okay, so we're now talking about SkyDrive. And do we want to switch over to my view, please?
Microsoft Cloud Solution is SkyDrive. And
yes.
SkyDrive is not a game. SkyDrive is not trivial. SkyDrive is robust. It's big. It is awesome.
It is. I mean, it's the evolution of a number of strategies. You know, you had Live Mesh out there. You had, I forget what the previous version was before Mesh.
I thought it was just SkyDrive.
Yeah, maybe a SkyDrive.
Yeah.
But effectively, this product has been evolving.
Oh, there was Sync. Remember that?
Yes, Sync. That's the one. So there was Sync, there was Live Mesh, and now we have SkyDrive. And it's been evolving. There's a lot of storage out there. It's pretty reasonably priced.
Not to mention it starts at 7 gigabytes for free.
For free.
And
if you're an enthusiast, you can often get the upgrade to 25.
Yes.
Lurking around. And if you went to build last year, you got 100 gigs.
Yeah. I wonder what they'll do this year.
Yeah.
200 gigs.
200 gigs.
You got to double it every year.
So anyway, that's what SkyDrive is. There are a bunch of guidelines that have been published that really talk about what you can do or how you should use Windows 8. Now, some of the initial guidelines said you cannot back up your application data using SkyDrive. They've since stepped back from that and turned around and said, well, actually, yes, okay, you can do so. And they've issued some guidelines around how you would do that, and we'll cover that in a moment. And we've actually incorporated that a little bit into the helper that we've started to build for this.
And that was a practical limitation. They used to block everything but document types or image types.
Yes.
And so you tried to save an XML file or something like that, and it would be blocked.
Exactly.
And so they removed that and allow now for data.
So some of the key things for typical usage scenarios of SkyDrive, not incorporating the application's kind of background interaction, is if you're going to upload to somebody's SkyDrive, say images or whatever, do so only in response to their actions. It's a common thread that we've kind of gone through beforehand, that don't surprise the user, don't do something that impacts their world, their environment, without their say-so. Use SkyDrive for what it does best. I mean, it is really based around delivering these rich web documents. You know, you've got the ability to edit in Word documents that are out there. You've got the ability to use PowerPoint and so on and so forth as part of your SkyDrive capability. Plus, you've got a great image viewing capability.
Yeah.
And you've got the ability to actually
just upgrade it. It's very cool.
Yeah, it's very, very slick.
Yeah.
You've got the ability to upload music and play music from there across the web. It's very, very slick.
Right on your phone. It'll stream to your phone.
Exactly.
Yeah,
you know,
cool.
It's impressive. And the other thing is, don't undermine trust. If you're going to be monkeying around with security, don't set things up so that by default everything's public. You know, honor people's security. Make sure that they feel like SkyDrive is a good place to interact. Don't undermine that with your applications. These are some key points.
Makes sense to me. And I think it's worth saying that every Microsoft account has SkyDrive there, right? We were talking about roaming, and that you can roam in Windows 8, that's stored in SkyDrive. As soon as you try to access SkyDrive, let's say they don't have a SkyDrive account because it's a brand new account. As soon as you try to access their SkyDrive, it auto-provisions, and you're ready to go.
Yep, it's there. 7 gigs for free. Use them.
Yeah, it's true.
So, moving to this slide. This is the guidelines around storing application data on SkyDrive. First of all, don't scatter it around here, there, and everywhere in their root directory. There's nothing's going to be more infuriating for users for them not to be able to find their own content because we've created Jerry and Darren's amazing app number one and Jerry and Darren's amazing app number two, and they can't see anything for these proliferation of folders in the root space.
And it's at risk now for your application because odds are they'll just delete it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, that's a top tip for building your application. Handle that scenario.
In case they delete.
In case they delete.
Not just delete, monkey with.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Goof around. So deal with that. Anyway, this is the pattern. So create a single folder, application data, in the root of SkyDrive. Mm-hmm. If there are other applications out there, they may have already created application data, and you will use that folder.
That's right.
Then create a subfolder within there that follows this pattern. Application name, so in our case, is what? Windows 8 Jumpstart is the application name. Then in parentheses, put your publisher name or your company name. This combination should disambiguate the fact that if somebody else produces an application called Windows 8 Jumpstart, they're highly likely not to be DPE USW.
Right.
And so that gives you a unique folder name. Okay? That's why these guidelines exist. And then inside that folder is where you're going to place your application-specific content. Okay?
Once you're in that folder, it's a free-for-all.
It's a free-for-all. You can do whatever you like.
Yeah.
Relatively speaking. Don't write 120 gigs of data up there because, again, they're going to be very unhappy if you've taken up all of their space.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Okay?
So the SkyDrive SDK, it's sort of similar to the Microsoft account, the way we interact with it.
Yeah, it's very, very similar. Effectively, it's all part of the Live SDK. And so it follows the same kind of infrastructure that we're actually interacting with REST-based endpoints. We're going to use HTTP operations to interact with those endpoints, push, post and put to upload, get to download, move and copy are verbs that we can leverage to move files on the remote system without having to download and re-upload, which is much more efficient on bandwidth and time.
Yeah.
The way that we interact with those, if we're not going to directly invoke the REST endpoints, is we use the Live Connect client to encapsulate our interactions. And what we see is there's a bunch of method calls on there, such as post async, which encapsulates your interaction with the post method, does so using a task, so we can use the await pattern to interact with these things and await for that response. So you have one for each one of the verbs that we talk about, plus we have a couple of extended ones that use some other system capabilities. When we're talking about permissions, it's worth bearing in mind that there's a cascade of permissions that comes down. You can't ever break the all of the permissions inheritance. So don't start assuming that you can start changing things and hiding them from the user who's SkyDrive you're working within or whatever.
So the first thing to realize is if the user hasn't logged in, you don't get to use SkyDrive.
Yes.
So you got to go through the first step, and then once you have access to SkyDrive, you go for the folders, go for the files. How do we interact with files and folders?
So that's a great question, and I think it's one thing that has stymied a few people when they've tried to use this API, is actually getting their head around the concepts. So let's start off with just initially thinking about some useful folder and file properties.
Okay.
These are the core elements that we need when we're interacting with these things. So basically, every folder and file has an ID. This ID starts off with a piece of text that says whether it's a file or a folder. It's then followed by what looks to be half a GUID, okay? And it's in lowercase. And then typically, it's followed by the same half a GUID in uppercase with an exclamation mark and some additional digits. I actually don't know the significance of those final digits, don't know if they are at all. If we do find out, we'll be sure to share somewhere on a post or whatever.
And by GUID, you mean GUID.
GUID, or you mean GIF or JIF.
Ping or PNG.
Indeed. So that is the unique identifier, and it's not the name that you give the file. That is reserved for the name property, which is, in our situation, we use episodenotes.txt.
Sure.
Okay? So here is the key thing. You will always be referencing these files by their ID when you're interacting with the API. Whenever you're creating something, you need that ID.
Now that is nice because a file can be renamed again and again and again.
Exactly,
and it doesn't consistent. Break anything.
And it's also it disambiguates because you can have an episode notes.txt in directory 1 and an episode notes.txt in directory 2.
Yeah.
If we were trying to find these things and assuming the file name was unique, that would be an awkward constraint to place on SkyDrive.
It would. Yeah.
And so we have to have this disambiguation, which is this ID. We also have a couple of other properties. There are a bunch more properties than I'm listing here, but these are useful to see. Description, name pretty much suggests what it is. We have type, which tells us whether the object we're interacting with is a file, an album, a picture, and so on and so forth.
It's not to be confused with extension that
yes.
talks about type. This
Correct.
Is type of object.
We also have the source path, and we need this if we're going to be able to download a file. Mm-hmm. And so that's the purpose of that, and we'll come... touch on this in a little bit more detail. But we want to kind of start talking about how we're going to be working with the SkyDrive API. And as Jerry mentioned, the important types are a live connect session, and we get that via the login.
That's our OAuth token that's initially done through the login.
Exactly. And so we leverage that in the live connect client. We require that valid session. If we're interacting with SkyDrive, as Jerry mentioned before, we need one of these two scopes. WL SkyDrive gives us read-only access. Mm. WL SkyDrive underscore update gives us both read and write. Okay?
So if I want SkyDrive update, I don't have to provide also SkyDrive.
Yep.
We did in our scopes, but just to
yeah,
show.
It does no harm to put it in.
Right.
There's no harm.
The compounding.
Yep. The other key element, and again, Jerry was interacting with this in his earlier calls, is the live operation result. Mm. And Jerry mentioned it's a dictionary. What's interesting is it's actually a dynamic dictionary, which allows us to use the dynamic keywords to interact with it as well. Even if we're using dynamic keywords, though, it's still not strongly typed. So you basically need to know what you're doing. You need to specify the property names correctly.
It's awful.
They're all lowercase.
It's awful.
It's a pain.
You have to get everything by literal strings.
Yep.
The type comes back as object. You have to recast them. It's painful.
So in our helpers, we're encapsulating a lot of that interaction so you don't need to worry about it. And we're passing back strongly typed objects that you can access these things directly with.
Right.
So when you're retrieving file or folder properties, as I said, you need to supply the item ID either as an ID or using one of the few friendly names that exist.
Okay.
Jerry's actually already mentioned one of them, which is /me. There is another one that gets to the root of your SkyDrive folder, which is /me/SkyDrive. So you can use that wherever you would ordinarily be using an ID, and that will always get you a reference to that SkyDrive location.
It's sort of like /my documents.
Exactly.
Only it's a mixture of documents, videos, and photos.
Correct.
Yeah.
So what we show here is just a little piece of code that shows how we're using. If our session, which is the session ID that Jerry's login normally returns, is equal to null, then we're going to go away and call login because we need to have a valid session before we come in. Now, this is a little bit of naive logic because it assumes that if you hit login that you log in.
Yeah.
But you know, for demonstration purposes, that's what we need. We're using that session then to create a new Live Connect client. Once we're there, we're actually saying get async, and we're calling an item ID, and we're bringing back the dynamic results. And so this is the pattern that we use when we're interacting with these APIs, and you've seen it, as I mentioned before, with Jerry's interactions.
You use the dynamic keyword there because from that point forward, you can say result.id,
result.name, and
right.
so on.
That you don't get IntelliSense, but it's easier than having to pass in the string.
Sure. So this is an example of how we can use that dynamic result to actually create a strongly typed value. So this is an initialized method that's as part of one of our strongly typed classes that takes in that dynamic result. And as you can see, result.id, result.name, you can see it's lowercased because again, this is coming across as part of a REST API. It's not following the naming conventions that we're normally expecting to see in C#, but I'm assigning those values directly into properties that I've exposed out from the encapsulating object there. So again, shows you how you can use it. But if I did a typo in upload underscore location, the compiler's not going to tell me anything. I'm just going to end up with either an exception or a null value, depending upon how things work. Okay?
I doubt you'd type it wrong.
It doesn't seem feasible, does it?
It does. I mean, after 24 sessions,
yeah,
we know the truth.
How could we make this?
We know the truth.
So Understanding folder and file hierarchy. This is one of the key impediments, I think, to really embracing this API. Bear in mind that whenever you want to access a folder, you're going to do so by its folder ID unless it's one of those special folders that has a friendly name. And we've listed some of them, me, SkyDrive, me, calendars, me, contacts, me, events. Yeah. Okay. But if you're interacting with your own directories, such as, say, application data, that doesn't have a friendly name. So you're going to need to find its ID.
And I think it's worth saying here that when you look for a folder by its ID, you would even find a subfolder by its ID. And everything is presented hierarchically, but actually flat.
Exactly. And that's part of what we're going to do on the next couple of slides, is really explore that to make sense of it.
Okay.
So imagine we want to download a file. And that file is called filename.txt. And we've created, say, through the regular SkyDrive UI, we've gone in and we're on the website and we've created a folder called Directory 1 in the root of your SkyDrive.
Yeah.
We've then navigated into Directory 1. And we've created another folder called Directory 2.
Yep.
We then navigate into Directory 2 and we upload a text file called filename.txt.
Got it.
So that's sitting out there. It's already created. How on earth do we navigate using the API to go and find these things, given we know the names, but we don't know the IDs?
Yeah. Again, that hierarchy is not real.
Yeah, it's presented. We have a logical hierarchy that gets evaluated for us and presented in that manner by the UI. This is how we actually discover that hierarchy.
I can't help it. It reminds me of a pirate. You know, put your file name in me SkyDrive. That's too good. All right.
Okay.
Sorry,
anyway, Jerry needs to carry on drinking, clearly. So, in order to retrieve a list of files and folders contained in Directory 1, and we don't know Directory 1's ID, we first need to get a list of the folders that are in me SkyDrive.
Who's?
Me. It's me, Jerry, damn it.
Me SkyDrive.
Exactly. So, in order to do that,
all right.
We basically interact with me SkyDrive, and somebody trimmed out my folders, didn't they? So in order to get a list of files that are in /me/SkyDrive, we have to do a get on /me/SkyDrive/files. And that returns back a list, a JSON object that contains an array of all of the files and folders that are present in SkyDrive. Using our helper, we can project that into a strongly typed object that allows us to do a link expression on there to turn around and find and say, okay, bring me back the metadata associated with a directory that has the name of Directory 1.
Okay.
We can then extract out the ID from that, and here is the human readable ID
right.
for the folder.
Of course. Yeah.
Directory 1 equals folder 96. No, I'm not going to read it.
Thanks. All right, so we're just barely into it.
Yeah.
Right?
What we now have is
the ID of Directory 1.
So now we need to get the folders that are available in Directory 1.
Now, look at that long string in Git async. Is that built by the SDK, or are you having to build that string manually?
So you're building that string manually.
Oh, boy.
We're putting that together. Brilliant. And our helper constructs this for us. Now, there's a little piece of syntax that you can see on there that we've got the folder ID that we just retrieved. We have /files. That tells us that we want to bring back the metadata for the files, but we also have this filter. So this query string filter equals folders constrains the list that we get back to only being folders. It doesn't list the files that are in there. So that makes this operation a little bit quicker.
Yeah.
Okay? There isn't, unfortunately, a filter that says only bring back files, which is strange and unfortunate. But that is the step. So this is going to bring back a data structure of the files that are contained, or the folders, I should say, that are contained by Directory 1, represented by its ID there.
Okay.
Somehow we went from step 3 to step 5.
Don't you remember step 4 was a repeat of getting the idea?
Exactly. So what we're turning around and saying is, that's how we got hold of Directory 1. We repeat that process, this time scanning through the folders that get returned from our query of Directory 1.
Looking for Directory 2.
Looking for Directory 2.
We find it, get the ID.
With those last steps, we've got Directory 2's ID, which is, again, this wonderfully human-readable string.
I mean, we wouldn't show this to a user, obviously.
Absolutely not.
Yeah.
But we're trying to help the developers understand how to interact with this.
Right.
Once we have Directory 2's ID, We then request a list of the files and folders in directory 2.
Okay.
So we've got slash files. We have no additional filter on there.
So we'll have to filter those out manually.
Exactly. And we're going to get back all of the contents of directory 2. Okay. Once we're there, we can then find filename.txt by, again, using our strongly typed class. We can do a link query on there to pull back the source. We have a property in the filename info that comes back from there called download path. This is the fully qualified URI that you can use to go and download that file. Okay? What we then do is we can't directly download a file from SkyDrive and arbitrarily place it anywhere on the file system.
Okay.
We're running inside the sandbox that the App Store environment gives us. Therefore, we need to have a storage file that we pass to the download. So again, you've seen this before in what Jerry was doing earlier on, but we're using application data.current.temporary folder, create file async. We're passing in a string that represents the name of the temporary file we want to create.
Okay.
Plus, we're specifying the collision options, which says if filename.txt is already there, replace it with a new file.
Okay, makes sense.
So that's what we're doing. So we're getting hold of a storage, local storage file. We then pass this into the Live Connect client, and we're using a new method called background download async.
That's interesting.
The download path is the download path that we retrieve back from the file information object related to filename.txt up in the SkyDrive. And the local storage file is the storage file we just created in our temporary folder.
Now, what's interesting about using background download is the background downloader service inside Windows 8, just like in Windows Phone.
Yep.
And an interesting thing is, let's pretend the file that you just selected is gigantic, a gigabyte, let's just say.
Yep.
The user doesn't have the patience, they close your application. The download still continues.
Exactly. It's going to carry on.
And it's wrapped with the logic that says, are we on a metered connection? Are we currently connected? Are we not? And it goes on from there, and it handles it for you.
So you get a lot of things for free.
Yeah, you really do.
The flip side of using that is that's why we have to hand over a local storage file, because we need to pass off to the background async or process, download and put it into there. Let us know when it's done. And that's what we're doing there with the await. But as Jerry mentions, the user doesn't have to wait. They can carry on and move forward.
Yep, that's right.
So that's how we download the file. So let's recap that. So the whole flow to go through was, first of all, we need to get the folders that are in Mi SkyDrive. We then need to find directory 1 from that list.
Got it.
Once we've got directory 1, we then want to get a list of the folders that are in directory 1 to find directory 2, step 4.
Yep.
Once we have directory 2, we can then find the files that are in directory 2, and we can then match the file name that we're looking for in directory 2 to get its download URL.
Yeah.
We can then create a local storage file as the download target, and we can then use the background download async to download the file in SkyDrive and place it into that local target file.
It is that simple.
Simple. Piece of cake. Don't know why anybody struggles to work out how to do this.
All right. Okay. Now, though, we've given it to you.
Exactly. And how hard can it possibly be?
I think we should probably look at the real code.
You think so?
Yeah. Let's go ahead.
Okay. Let's do that. So, first things first. Let's talk about how we actually deal with initiating our download.
Okay.
So you mentioned we do all our long-running processes in SkyDrive, in the splash screen, I should say. And certainly going through and iterating, doing multiple calls out to a web server is going to take more than a few milliseconds.
Indeed.
And so that is definitely a candidate for something you want to do during your splash screen startup. And so what we have as part of the long-running actions method in our splash screen code behind, at the bottom here we have await episode notes.getNotes. Episode notes is kind of our view model, our encapsulation of the interaction with...
Are we doing something wrong? We're good?
Nobody's showing my code?
I wonder if...
No code, I just have PowerPoint.
You're on the wrong screen.
Try his screen.
I've got 6 and both of them are showing PowerPoints.
Well, that's weird.
That's weird, because...
see if you're still projecting.
You're still projecting.
although that doesn't make any sense at all.
Yeah. Okay. Try now.
There we go.
Small technical detail. I'm still waiting for my screen to come back. You can see the desktop now?
I can see your PowerPoint.
Can you now see code?
I've got code.
Code is live. Okay, let's start again.
I thought you were faking this whole thing. just for credibility purposes, I'm glad that came up. All right.
Exactly. Okay, so we're in our splash screen XAML.code behind. And again, I was showing that we have this log running actions, which should be long running actions.
Oh, gosh, English.
Let me change that for you, Jerry.
Nice.
Okay, long running actions. And at the bottom here, this is where we're going to go out and get our notes. So this is a static method. It's basically a factory method on our episode notes class that's okay. going to interact with SkyDrive. So let's flick out and have a look at get notes. So this is our class, and we'll go into these other areas in a moment. But basically, we have a static async method that's going to get notes, and it's going to return back an instance of episode notes. Mm. We have a static member variable that is of type episode notes that's going to hold our instance of episode notes once we've created it. So this is a singleton. Mm. We check to see, have we already created one? If so, then we return it instantly. We don't go through this whole scenario.
Right.
So this allows us to access this consistently throughout the rest of the application.
Got it.
I initialize a little piece of JSON here, which is my fallback for creating an instance of my type if I have no data that's uploaded anywhere.
Okay.
So I'm going to create a new empty episode notes, should that be the default action. So here's where we start to make life a little bit simpler for ourselves. We have our SkyDrive helper there that says get or create application data folder. And we pass into that the app name for SkyDrive. So if I flick out and have a look at that definition, here we have a string that's defined, and this is our name for the subfolder inside application data. So this is going to, as the name suggests, either bring back the ID, mm-hmm. or the folder information, I should say, for this folder, or it's going to create it and then bring it back.
I can imagine the logic that you have behind it. It makes plenty of sense, right? Test it first to see if it's there, create it, then go get it, then return it.
So we can drive into that a little bit later if we need to, but right now we're going to show that this is now of a type SkyDrive folder info, and we can look at that, and that has the properties that are available for us to use if we want to. The next thing we're doing is we want to get hold of our SkyDrive file information, the notes that we've uploaded. And so we have a save notes file name. If I click on this, we can see this is savenotes.txt. If we come back, we can see that we're using this app data folder ID property. So this is the folder ID that we needed to download to be able to interact with the contents of this. So we're saying get this file name from this folder. And that's going to bring back the file information that we need to interact with this file. If we found it, i.e. it's not equal to null, then we're going to do something. Otherwise, we're going to fall through and create an instance of the episode notes class with an empty content because we haven't yet created any notes that need to be uploaded. If it's not equal to null, then we're going to create our local file name that we're going to download the folder into. So we're going to create our storage file. So that's what the type of this is a storage file. We're going to then use our SkyDrive helper to download a file. We're using the download path of the file that we downloaded, or the information, I should say, the metadata for our save notes file in SkyDrive. And we're supplying in the storage file that we want to interact with. And then basically, we're going to use, once that's completed, that download, we're going to run into here and read the text from that file into our JSON variable. And so the text that we've stored in there is a serialized object, which is JSON. Once we then receive that JSON, it's either the default JSON or the JSON we've downloaded, we then come back to creating an instance of our episode notes. If I click into this constructor, we can see that very simply we're using JSON.net, in actual fact here, to deserialize that string into a dictionary of strings. This dictionary of strings basically has our episode ID plus the notes for our episode. That's effectively what
we're storing. As easy as you could do it.
As easy as we could do it.
Yeah.
We've created an easy shorthand to interact with these. We've created indexes that takes a session ID and uses that to access into our episode notes. If that session ID doesn't exist, then it returns back an empty string.
Yeah.
And allows us to write back in by specifying, okay, a set value on this property with a session ID is going to write the value back into our episode notes. It detects to see whether it's already there. If it's not there, it adds that to our dictionary.
Yep.
Otherwise, it updates the value. So that's pretty simple and straightforward. So that happens at this point here. The next time we need to interact with our notes is actually within the detail view.
You use the singleton pattern, so when we do get to that point,
exactly,
it's waiting for you.
When I get to that point, it is waiting for me. So if I come into the detail view model, during our start, our initialization of our view model, we load our data. In the load data runtime, right at the top here, I interact with get notes. So I get hold of the instance variable of our instance notes. Once that's been populated, I make sure that I raise this property changed on notes, and that ensures that the notes values are bound, because this may arrive a little bit later than once the UI has been rendered. And so I want to make sure that those notes values are pushed out into the binding.
Yep. This is certainly last in wins.
It's last in wins for certain. So here we have just a very simple...
Maybe you should zoom in just a hair. There you go.
So here we have a very simple property that exposes out the notes. We handle the situation where asynchronously the notes may not have yet been populated,
yep,
and return an empty string rather than getting an exception. Otherwise, we then return back using the indexer the notes for this ID.
Yep.
When we write those values, we also write into, using this indexer, the value that we want to write.
That's a lot of, I mean, it is simple, but it's a lot of functionality with so little work.
With so little work, absolutely. Yeah. And so let's have a look at the XAML just to see how we're binding this. So we actually have a little custom control that we've created here, bindable text box.
Ah.
And this addresses a limitation of the current text box implementation.
Yep.
So in both Silverlight and WPF, you had the ability to access the binding expression that you created when you were bound to a particular value. You could then create an attached property that was detecting your text changed event and refreshed or updated your binding expression to push through into your background binding every time you typed, hit a key, and edited the text, and pushed into your binding that changed text.
Wait, so here's the problem. You're typing typing. I'm just helping you out because I can tell you're getting tired. Your voice is starting to show the signs. As I'm typing it in your text box, no event is being raised to cause the binding to update.
Exactly.
Event was raised, I can't reach into the binding and update it.
By default, the binding is only updated once the text box loses focus.
Yeah. That's brutal.
And that pushes a text.
You can turn that
event
off, or you can fix that in WPF. You can fix that in Silverlight, but you're trapped here. So we have this bindable text box. Very nice implementation, too. Simple.
Absolutely, very simple. And it's also, this control also handles the challenge we were talking about, where you search on type. Mm. That once this control gets focus, it switches off the search on type, and once it loses focus, it switches it back on. Now again,
that's
this
a nice feature. Yeah.
It's a naive implementation right now for the purposes of this demo. We can make it more robust by ensuring that we reset the state to what it was previously. Because if you'd never set
search on type in the first place
we don't want to turn it on just arbitrarily, because that could be confusing. So that's how we do this. And effectively what we do is on the navigate away from here is when we push a save back. So we haven't really talked about the save. But the save is pretty easy once we have the file ID.
Ah.
We know how to write back to the application.
Okay.
So in the stop, we call episode notes.save. And this is us leaving our view model. Now, you may wish to implement a background process that saves this text file periodically so you don't lose any changes and so on and so forth. Or you may choose that the action of navigating away from here is what commits the write. So you've got a couple of different strategies you can employ here, but basically this is the save. So let's go and look at how that works. First thing we do is we get hold of our dictionary and we serialize it to JSON. Then we basically create a local file, a storage file, that's going to contain this JSON. We then write that JSON to the local storage file. And then because we already have the folder ID of the SkyDrive update folder,
right,
we can now use just a very simple upload file,
yeah,
the file we want to upload, the file name we want to upload to on SkyDrive,
mm-hmm,
and write it. And it's as simple as that.
Do you know how collisions are handled?
The collisions, if we actually go in here, we can actually specify how collisions are handled. So I can zoom in there. We can say overwrite option is set to overwrite.
I
so that's
see.
What I have by default in the helper.
Yeah, which makes plenty of sense.
Okay.
Well, that's easy.
That's easy, using the helper.
That was easy. We need that right now.
We do need that. That was easy.
Beautiful.
And so that's really simplified what is, in actual fact, a pretty complex set of scenarios. If you're really interested in understanding the meat and potatoes of interacting with SkyDrive at the much more granular level that we were talking about initially, go in and dive into SkyDrive Helper. As I would say, we put this together very much to satisfy the scenarios mm-hmm. that we've built out in this particular demo. We do intend to continue working on this and make it a little bit more robust, deal with errors, scenarios, in perhaps a more intuitive way, and deal with many, many other scenarios that SkyDrive deals with.
Yeah.
You know, this is very much encapsulated around the idea of reading and writing and saving files.
Yeah, and that, that doesn't deal with albums and things like that, right?
Correct.
Which is a little trickier.
A little trickier. Well, can be trickier, but it's different, definitely, from what we're doing right now.
Yeah. Cool.
Okay.
All right. So we talked about how you log in, using your Microsoft account so you can authenticate, using your Microsoft account so you can single sign-on, using your Microsoft account to be able to access your profile information and interact with the user in a friendly way, and then be able to use that authentication token to leverage their services like SkyDrive. And then the tricky way of interacting with SkyDrive to list things, to find the files inside a directory or to find other directories inside the directory, because there's not a .git subfolders like we're used to in storage folder, right? There's a lot of little pieces that we've done,
mm-hmm.
and it makes it right. Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah.
Great.
Darren, I can't tell you how happy I am to be done with this.
I have to say, you know, if I have to sit opposite from you one more time.
No, it's been great. It has been great. You know, always the teacher learns more than the student. I feel like I've learned a ton, and I felt like I knew a lot to start with, so it's pretty good.
Yeah.
Now, one thing I can't get over, and I know is true, is the entire day, you have been jealous of my new mustache that I'm growing.
Uh-huh.
So I brought you a small mustache that
Perfect.
You can use. And this is a high-tech mustache, so if you squeeze it, it talks to you as well. It says, well, hello.
Well, hello there.
That's nice, isn't it?
That's pretty awesome.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. So this is, you know, kind of a memento of
uh-huh.
Microsoft Virtual Academy. You can download your own at xaml.codeplex.com. Does that even make sense? No, you can't do that. Nonetheless, I will just remind you, all of this is at microsoftvirtualacademy.com. This is one of three entire day courses, each one progressing slowly through all of the stack that you need to know, from C# to basics of XAML, to complex and advanced scenarios like we were just talking about.
And we will update the source code to reflect the version that we finally submit to the store. So any additional scenarios that we put in there will be available up there. And we'll correct the little minor glitch that there is in the solution right now with the ghost project that exists that's been causing some confusion.
Now let's see, Darren, you're at crank211.com.
That's
where
me.
We can find your company. You're on Twitter. As I am, you're at Darren May, 1 R. I'm at Jerry Nixon, 2 R's.
Indeed.
And no doubt about it.
Absolutely.
Thank you for watching. And have any other final things I should say?
Nope. I guess
Take
not.
The quiz. We have a poll. Don't forget the poll. And don't forget Barry. Big shout out to you.
Woo-hoo!
for the other evangelists who helped with the question and answer during the last few days. Thank you for all of your support. For all of you who held with us all this time, and everybody in Norway,
thank you very much. Goodbye.